then maybe you know a good family history will give a good insight, and someone can give some advices. So I think what we are referring to here is a good lengthy family history where you know it can help the genetic counselor
to. So then maybe you know should discuss with their healthcare providers their family history, something like that.
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay.
Yeah, we knew this was going to be difficult and controversial, but the vote clearly shows that it is a difficult and controversial. So, someone said breast ultrasound. So what does the panel believe? The wording is breast ultrasound is not a screening method. Screening method. Yes, no, abstain.
It's double negative.
Okay.
Okay, anyway, I think the majority clearly says we have no data of high quality saying that you can use an ultrasound as a screening method. It's different for diagnosis, of course.
Me.
Next point.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Now the automated breast ultrasound, it is used in screen, not the handheld. The question should have been more precise. If you were speaking about the handheld ultrasound, it's no. But for the automated breast ultrasound, it is used for screening.
No, we have no high-level evidence for that.
That's why
there's little studies that suggest something.
I think that all agree. I think that when you say a negative assessment, yes means that you agree with the negative assessment. So there has been some confusion. Some of us voted no, wanted to say that this is not.
Yes.
It's not screening.
It's not
I said it's diagnostic, but it's not screening at this point in time.
Absolutely. Yes, please.
So I agree that there is no evidence that ultrasound could be used for screening, and it can even be misleading. It needs a lot of education to become a professional in breast ultrasound. So I would really encourage people to do use it for screening. It is a complementary method for mammogram.
Agree. 21.
Okay. Genetic counseling is part of the requirements of breast cancer risk reduction tools and should be inserted in the cancer control programs. Yes, no, abstain.
And I speak of counseling, not of testing.
Okay, I think self-explanatory. We move to 22. There is a need to improve genetic counseling services in MENA region.
Those of you who are from Switzerland can abstain.
Say yes on my behalf, please. Yeah. Okay. Question number 23. There is a need for prospective clinical studies that address alternative modalities and modified breast cancer screening programs in areas of limited resources.
Anyone voting no will have an electric shock. You see how effective I am? Okay. Question number 24. Risk reduction modalities. There is a need to develop a specific risk assessment tool that considers the disease and socioeconomic criteria in areas of limited resources. Yes, no, abstain. The vote is not going forward. Come on, come on, come on, come on. There we go.
Only 10 voters.
Okay, so the number of voters is not very high, and clearly there are some people that say that there's no specific tool to be developed, so it would be interesting to know who said no and why. So we stop here, re-zero the whole question, and we re-vote the question. There we go, re-vote. The system is still saying one.
It's very quick.
All right, starting again. The system is getting tired. It's a little bit better, but still very few votes. It's less, not working.
Indeed, it's less. It was 10 voters, now 9.
Yeah.
So, so there's something wrong.
There's a technicality issue here. No, no, don't put that blue up yet. Just wait a second. Allow everyone to be ready. You're ready, set, go, blue. With 18, you seem to have to a reasonable vote here. Let's move.
We need our screen.
We need our screen. Take this time up away from our screen, please.
No, we need our screen on the computer,
our screen
please.
Here. We are fully aware the time is up, but we had to solve with the technical issues. Thank you. Okay, question number 25. Don't worry, there are not many left anymore. Risk reduction modalities include bilateral mastectomy or subcutaneous, are discussing risk benefit in BRCA mutational carriers. Bilateral salpingophorectomy with peritoneal wash in BRCA mutational carriers, tamoxifen for both premenopausal and postmenopausal, AI for postmenopausal. Of course, the clinical indication will vary. Are all of these risk reduction modalities? Yes, no, abstain.
Are we voting for all of the answers?
Yes, no. All of the answers. Are these considered risk reduction modalities in specific clinical situations?
Yeah. Not on the same patient, of course.
Okay, thank you very much. We move forward. Still risk reduction modalities. To whom do you offer that? Risk reduction modalities should be offered to, and your answer will comprise, only to those with presumably genetic predisposition to breast cancer, and only to those whose breast cancer risk is more than 1.7% at 5 years as calculated by an expert. Yes, no, abstain. Okay, there are some no's, but because of the time being up,
can we hear one no?
I would, okay, Ahmed is too kind. He's asking one no to raise the hand. Professor Pujol?
Thank you. Just, I think we mixed together two situations that have not the same power in terms of risk. A Gale score at what point? 7. Have nothing to do with BRCA1 mutation, so, and I think the question should be a little bit more with nuance.
I think we would all agree with that. I will have to dispense Jose, sorry. Let's move. 27. The panel believes that hormonal agents can be used for risk reduction in those with BRCA mutation A, only if surgical modalities are not accepted by the patients. Does this make any sense? Yes, no, abstain. Clearly divided vote. We'll go to the next and then we'll discuss the whole question. So the next one is, Hormonal agents can be used for risk reduction dose of BRCA mutation combined with risk reduction surgical modalities. Yes, no, abstain. So it's a no for hormonal agents. Now, comments. Yes, in the back, Dr. Armin, yeah. Yes.
So for tamoxifen or aromatase inhibitors or raloxifen, there are absolutely no prospective data in mutation carriers. So it's going to be very difficult. I mean, we discuss it, but I discuss the absence of data with the patient because they always ask. And especially if it's a BRCA1 mutation, you know, they tend to develop 70% of the time ER negative breast cancer. So it's even, you know, more difficult to justify the usage. However, these are in unaffected individuals. In patients with breast cancer and the mutation, if they don't do contralateral mastectomy, and if they have had ER-positive disease, then maybe, you know, they can receive tamoxifen or AI in the adjuvant setting. And some studies showed that contralateral breast cancer might be decreased in those, but that's a, you know, very different circumstance and not, you know, primary prevention in unaffected individuals.
Point well taken, yeah.
Excellent. Thank you very much for the comment. This, I think, clarified the whole situation. Hope?
We talked on the previous question about risk reduction should be offered to people who have, you know, a BRCA mutation or a risk of 1.7%. But earlier we talked about risk reduction strategies being counseling on weight loss and not drinking much alcohol, blah, blah, blah. So the thing is, that should be for every woman. So I think the question is a little bit misleading in that, because I don't think you mean like living a healthy, good life, right? That should only be people at high risk.
No, what we wanted to discuss was really the position of the hormonal manipulation in BRCA-positive patients, which I think was very nicely clarified by the previous comments. So let's move to 28. And 28 is, hormonal treatment for risk reduction should be offered for, and there'll be several votes, and then we can discuss, for 5 years, yes, no, abstain.
Okay, we will. The next one is until menopause.
I didn't see this question. It was yesterday. Wait. We'll
okay,
go through everything.
No. We'll go to C. Can we have C on the screen, please? Yeah. Until non-manageable side effects. Okay. So again, divided, we will discuss. And the last one, I think, until age of 70. Okay, so we start with the last one. I think there is a clear consensus that 70 is not the age. If we can go to the previous one, previous vote,
27.
C, until non-manageable side effects. No, go to the previous one, please, yeah. We expected more yes, but the total voter is...
should be, you know, 5 years or unmanageable side effects, whichever comes first. It's a little unclear.
Please.
I think this question just illustrates the fact that it's random multiple choice questions, one after the other, so you get random results. I think you should actually discount the whole of this question, in my view.
Okay.
Yeah, we didn't like the way the question, when we discussed, was done this morning, so we decided to divide it into four, but we fully accept that this question is not very well worded And we should have reworded, but we were under pressure of time. We had other sessions to go to. So if there are any other comments about this?
If we have 5 years or until non-manageable toxicity, can we vote on that? Because we need to help them, you know, sort of have a stand.
Okay, so can we go to 28A? A, there we go. So you put this one to zero. Don't start. Put to zero, and it is understood that this means for 5 years or until unmanageable toxicity. Whichever comes first. Okay, everyone understood this? Now you can put the blue on and you vote. Yes, no, abstain.
Okay,
it's clear. Thank you very much. And now we move to question 29, please. Question 29, a well-established, we're changing completely topics now. This is about cancer control programs, and we need some guidance from the panel to help in some situations. A well-established referral system to tertiary, highly specialized oncology centers for newly diagnosed breast cancer cases within 2 weeks of diagnosis is of ultimate importance to improve breast cancer treatment outcome. This is to improve organization. Yes, no, abstain. We need the blue. There we go. Okay, thank you. Question 30. No, sorry, we have to move because...
Well, it's very important not to encourage the practice of removing lumps outside of specialist centers, as is happening, excuse my American colleagues, in some U.S. centers. We don't want patients to be diagnosed outside the cancer center, ideally.
Okay, number 30. There should be an educational program to primary healthcare professionals on how to do follow-up for cancer survivors to reduce the need to go to the tertiary centers for follow-up. Yes, no, abstain.
We're going to have to convince the primary doctors that they should do that, as they don't want to.
That's another, just a second. Let's have the vote first. Okay, now Professor Khaled.
I think this has to be included also in the undergraduate education in medical schools.
Yeah, well, I remember in medical school learning everything about rare pediatric disease. I forgot it already. So, 31. There is a need to establish a network between oncology centers for experience exchange and partnership development, i.e., this collaboration we have in this room should be standard. Yes, no, abstain. This is a great, thank you very much. Question 32. There is a need for rehabilitation programs and programs for those patients living surviving cancer that meet their socioeconomic needs. Yes, no, abstain. Yes, we want to leave you on a positive note. Thank you again. 33. There should be increase in specialized palliative and supportive care centers to meet the need of patients at all stages of cancer. This includes involvement of the primary healthcare facilities and professionals. Yes, no, abstain. Okay. 34. We change, and now it's about health system links with breast cancer. National population-based cancer registries, as well as other relevant surveys and data collection tools, should be used to collect high-quality population-based incidence and mortality data on breast cancer for all age groups by cancer type to guide policies and plans. Yes, no, abstain.
Again, very positive note. Last one. There must be a clear effort to promote and support clinical research to access high-quality breast cancer prevention and treatment, with understanding the organization of the health system in order to maximize access to and affordability of breast cancer prevention and treatment.
Okay, someone abstained, probably our colleague who actually did this very nice wording, which nicely summarizes the background, which is the reason why we had to go through this exercise, and many important messages have been coming forward thanks to the debate of the panelists. So with this, I would like to thank very much Hesham for having organized once again this meeting with Ahmed and many other colleagues. And the last words go to him.
Thank you very much, and I hope that you will enjoy the dinner, and please, we will have a group photo now, and also the attendees, if you want to have a photo with us, come after the first photo with the faculty. Please, thank you.
Here.